Good morning, Bridgepoint. How are y'all doing this morning? Good. I hope you made your way here through the fog. It looks like it's cleared up. Hey, if you are a visitor here with us this morning, we want to welcome you to Bridgepoint. We believe that every person here has a next step with Jesus. So whether that means you've been to church, this is your 1,000th Sunday to church, or this is your first Sunday to ever come in, we believe that Jesus has something for you. So we're excited, and we anxiously await what he has for us this morning. In order to prepare our hearts for what he has for us, I'd love it if we could go before him in prayer. So let's bow our heads and go to him in prayer. Lord, we love you, and we're grateful for a chance to be here together, shoulder to shoulder with brothers and sisters in Christ. God, we're excited that in you we have a family to belong to, and in you we have purpose, and in you we have a hope. God, I pray that we would cling to that this morning, and that we wouldn't cling to our circumstances or the things that are around us. God, would you work in our hearts this morning? Would you speak through Tom? Would you move this time? Lord, take our hearts wherever they are and make them yours. It's in your son's precious name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
The King is exalted on high, and I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. For he is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. The King is exalted on high. Sing that again. He is exalted. He is exalted. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever. Exalted. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. Sing, for you are the Lord. Let's make this our prayer this morning. For you are the Lord, forever your truth shall reign. In your holy name, you are the Lord, forever your truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in your holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. Sing, you are exalted. Oh, you are exalted, the King is exalted on high. You are exalted, the King is exalted. is exalted on high.
Amen. This next song, it has a tension in it. And I love the songs that we get to sing that talk about the tension that we have in life. That while we have a hope in Christ Jesus, we still toil along in this life. And life can be hard. We can be in tough circumstances. But it's great to know that while we are in that, we have a hope and we have a future. And there's the chorus in this song says that one day we're going to feast in the house of Zion. That one day all the pain, all the suffering, all the things that we have that around us that are going wrong are going to be made right by a king who is not going to be elected, by the way. Jesus is the rightful king. And so we have a hope in that. So, friends, this morning, let's go before him and make that our song and our prayer. So, we will feast.
We will feast in the house of Zion. Our hearts restored. He has done great things. We will say together, we will feast and weep no more. We will not be burned by the fire. He is the Lord. Held, protected, gathered up, we will feast in the house of Zion. We will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things. We will say together, we will feast and we. In the dark of night, before the dawn, my soul be not afraid, for the promised morning, oh how long, oh God of Jacob, be of Zion, we will sing with our hearts restored. He has done great things. We will say together, we will feast and we know every vow we've broken. You are the faithful one, and from the garden to the grave, bind us together, bring shalom. We will feast in the house of Zion.
Good morning. I am really glad you're here today. Welcome and thank you for being here. I know you all had a lot of different things that you could be up to today and that you've taken time to come and So I'm going to put my eyes on Jesus. We're going to walk with him. We're going to worship together with others. We really appreciate that and look forward to the trust that you've given to us, that this will be a time that is of benefit to you and your relationship with God, and it'll provide hope and strength as you go throughout the week. So really, really pleased that you're here. If you're new to us, welcome. We, you know, the ways we describe what we're about at Bridgepoint is we really feel like that there's a next step in Christ for everybody. There always is. Whether you're on a mountaintop or whether you're down in a valley, you know, there's always a next step. You're never at the end. You're never so deep in the weeds that he doesn't have a purpose for you, a plan for you. And so that's the great confidence and hope that we have, and trust that today will help all of us in taking some next steps from where we're at right now. And so welcome to you. One of the things that we do sometime is to help some parents to take next steps as well. We recognize that God has created us for community, and one of the ways that he's fashioned us for that is the privilege of raising kids, children, and he gives some real clear directions to us. He says, you know, raise up your children the way that they should go, and when they're old, they won't depart from it. And parents, raise up your children in the training, the admonition of the Lord. And so we have lots of folks who are in that process, and we want to acknowledge a couple of them this morning. So we are going to invite, in our time of infant dedication, I'm going to invite Peter Gruen to come up and have Peter bring his mom and dad, Kelsey and Tom, and his older brother, Henry. And then I'm also going to invite Mara Wilkinson and have Mara come and bring her mom and dad, Andrew and Emma, along with her. Gruen, so let's just have you kind of step a little further this way. Yeah. Good. Well, not that. Yeah, right. Stay right in here so everybody can see you still. That's great. All right. Good. This is Henry. Good morning, Henry. And this is Kelsey and Tom and Peter. All right. And this is Wilkinson. This is Emma and Andrew. And this is Mara. And we're really delighted to have all of them with us here this morning. And it's kinetic. It's alive. This is fantastic. Yeah. And before we go further, I just want to ask both sets of parents a couple questions as you're standing here this morning. Have each of you come to the place where you have placed your faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Yeah. And you stand here this morning with your children as a way of saying we desire to raise them in a Christian home where we're looking to the Lord for strength and looking to the Scripture for wisdom and guidance along the way. Yeah. And as best you understand, you're going to endeavor to hold Mara and to hold Peter with open hands before the Lord for God's work in their life as he sees fit as their days unfold. Yeah, great, great. Well, one of the things that we ask of parents when we're preparing for this day is for them to choose a scripture passage or a verse that sort of captures something of their heart and the hope that they have for their child. And to share that with us. And I'm going to start with the Wilkinsons. Andrew, can you tell us about what you and Emma have done with Mara?
All right. Thank you, Tom.
Yeah.
We really want Mara to grow up knowing that the Lord is her restorer, her healer. And much like in Exodus 15:26, after the Israelites were walking through the desert and came across the bitter waters of Mara, they called upon the Lord, and the Lord restored the waters, made it sweet to drink and safe to drink. So we want her to be able to call upon the Lord when she needs to be restored or be healed. And our verse is Exodus 15:26. The Lord said, "If you will diligently obey the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight and pay attention to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I'll put none of these diseases upon you like I did to the Egyptians, for I am the Lord, your healer."
Beautiful. Thank you guys for that. All right. Do you think she'll come to me? Come here, Mara. Oh, you're beautiful, little one. Come here. Let's go see these people. All right. This is Mara Wilkinson. All right. Isn't she beautiful? Yeah. I just like to invite you to join me in praying for Mara here this morning and for Andrew and Emma. Would you join me? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this young life. And I thank you that this great gift that you have entrusted to Andrew and Emma. Thank you, Lord, for the way that they have prepared themselves for this privileged journey that you have launched them on. And they hold their little one as a gift before you, as a treasure, and as a trust. Lord, I pray that you would equip them every day with the wisdom and the strength that are necessary to shape Mara, to lead her, to guide her, to comfort her, to strengthen her. Lord, I join with them in praying the truths of Exodus 15, Lord, over this young life. Thank you, Lord, that you're the one who transformed the bitter waters in that place to something sweet and refreshing and life-giving. That in that place you declared yourself to be Jehovah Rapha, the healer. Oh, Lord, would Mara experience that in her life in every way? Lord, that she would come to wholeness and fullness in you through faith in Jesus Christ. That she would be a vessel of your blessing, of your sweetness, of your life and your light to others throughout her life. Would you protect her, Lord? Would you strengthen her? Would you give sweet gifts to her along the way? Lord, we thank you for her. We lift her to you, and we pray your blessing on this family in every way you know to be best, Lord. In the name of the Creator God Himself, Jesus. In His name we pray. Amen. Oh, thank you. Hey, good morning. Good. All right. Yeah. Sweetness for the Wilkinsons. Yeah. Love you guys. All right. Sweet. This is sweet. All right. And this is Peter. And Peter Walter Gruen. And Tom, can you want to tell us a little bit about what you guys are doing, or Kelsey, whoever? Yeah. Oh, I can hold that too for you. Here, let me do that for you.
Yeah. Great, thank you. Yeah. So our verse for Peter is from Colossians 3, starting at verse 12. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bearing with one another and forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you.
Well, that's great. Was it? Is he done?
No, one more verse.
One more verse.
Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity.
Oh, amen. That is great. Good. All right. Peter, come here. Oh, little guy. Good to see you this morning. Man, if you get up close, you can see big blue eyes on this guy. This is Peter Walter Gruen. Yeah. And would you join me in praying for him? Lord, we thank you for this man, this young man. Lord, thank you that you wove him together, that you have fashioned him, Lord, in ways that according to your heart and your hope for his life. Father, I thank you for that. I pray for your work in his life, that he would be, as his namesake, Peter in the New Testament, that he would be a rock, that he would be a man of strength, that he would find life and mission in you. Lord, I think of the way that Peter's described in Acts chapter 4, where it was obvious to others that he had been with Jesus, particularly because he was marked with courage. Lord, would you work in the life of Peter Gruen in a way that he would be a man of courage, a man after your own heart, a man of strength throughout the days of his life. Lord, I pray for Tom and for Kelsey, and I pray for Henry. I pray that Henry would be the best big brother to Peter, that he would have a heart of understanding and encouragement towards his younger brother. I pray that you'd give Tom and Kelsey the strength and the wisdom needed for every day. Lord, sustain them, encourage them as they journey forward as a family. And I pray that Peter's life would be marked as well by the compassion, the unity, and the love that they've spoken over his life from the book of Colossians. Lord, we thank you for this family. We pray you'd outpour your goodness upon them and through them in many ways, manifold ways, throughout the years. We lift them to you now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thank you, Mr. Peter. All right. Yeah. Good. Thank you guys for coming up here and parenting in public. It's not always easy. We've all been there. Yeah. Hey, we're going to take our offering now. If you're a visitor to Bridgepoint, don't feel any obligation. This is a family time of worship to the Lord. You're welcome to if you'd like. And if you are a regular Bridgepointer, we always ask that you have your heart before the Lord and what He would have you to do. But anyhow, let's worship the Lord in this way as Will and the guys lead this forward. Thank you.
Find in me thy all in all.
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as stain, he washed it white as and when before the to say my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, washed it white as let's cry out to the God who saves us. Praise the one. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. The one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Jesus paid. Jesus paid it all. To him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Almighty God, you have saved us and you've redeemed us. You have taken the broken things and the broken people that we are and made us new in Christ Jesus. I pray in light of that, because of that, that we would live lives that are dispensers of grace. Just as we have received, we would freely give. God, would you work in our hearts because we're not there yet? Would you every day call us closer and closer to you to become more like you? God, I pray that you'd start with us this morning. Pray your word would speak to us. Pray for Tom as he opens it up. Lord, would you meet us where we are? It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Will. If you have a Bible with you, you can open to Psalm 146 in your Bible or on your phone or your tablet or whatever you happen to use. That's where we'll be this morning, Psalm 146. And as you're getting there, I'm guessing that you're similar to me, that you've had occasions or crossroads in your life. And in that crossroad, it seemed like everything, the balance and the future of life itself, sort of hung on that moment. For me, the first one of those moments I can remember was in Mrs. Erlinger's fourth grade class. You see, in the fourth grade at Maryville Elementary School, it was then that students were expected to learn their multiplication tables up through multiples of 10. And the proof that you had learned them was a four-minute test that was given every Wednesday afternoon until you got them all right. Once you passed on subsequent Wednesday afternoons, you got to walk down this long, three-story-long metal fire escape that ran down the outside wall of the old brick building. And once you got down there, you got to enjoy an extra recess while those inside were still striving for multiplication mastery, right? And on the day that I remember, I was now like at least two or three rounds in to my efforts at arithmetic acceptability. The teacher came around and she set that mimeograph piece of paper in front, you know, the slick paper with that strangely attractive chemical aroma and the kind of faint purple print on the page. She put it out in front of us there and in some sort of teacher version said, go, and started the clock. And I can remember the clock is running, and as the clock's running, I know that my pulse is quickening and my face is getting flush, and I can feel adrenaline plowing through my body like Sherman to the sea. I'm not too long into the thing, and I'm saying, 8 times 7, 8 times 7, what is 8 times 7? I'm telling you, I was frantic, and from my 10-year-old outlook, it seemed like all of life hung on the question of 8 times 7. Now, I got to tell you, I honestly don't remember if I passed the test that day. I suppose that I eventually did. But now, looking back 46 years later, to that moment, I can tell you this. Now, the panic of that moment seems silly. Seems silly. I lack perspective. I needed a hand to come along and be placed on my shoulder to speak some kind of understanding into my life. I need a voice of maturity to whisper into my ear to tell me, work hard, do all you can, don't be lazy, but do not mistake. Life is much bigger than this moment. Now, you may be asking yourself two things this morning. The first may be, I think this guy needs therapy, and you may be right. The second thing that may be in your mind is, I wonder why he's telling us this. I tell you all that to tell you this. Many Christians are behaving towards this election season the way that I behave towards that test. All of the vitriol, the debate, all of the scandal, all of the predictions of apocalyptic consequences are making people frantic. And I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't take this seriously. This is a serious time and we should be serious about it. We should do or we should have done our homework. We should campaign. We should advocate for issues and values. We should engage in rigorous discourse. We should vote, and we should vote down the ballot into all the different races that are set before him. But friends, as followers of Christ, we should not be frantic. I mean, even if the worst of the predicted consequences would become reality, the follower of Christ should not be shaken as those who have no hope. And I do not like it when things get more difficult, but in a sense, a Christian is even made for adversity, the way a four-wheel drive truck is made for mud. It's where we do our best. Just take a look at the flourishing church in places like Iran and China and Afghanistan as indications of that. What we need is perspective. I'm guessing that you've had plenty of voices speaking into your lives about the candidates and the contests. And I'm not another one of those. But it is my hope today and next week to go to this sacred prayer book called the Book of Psalms and to let two of God's expressions in those places to be like a hand of understanding on our shoulders and to be like a voice of sanity speaking in our ears to provide some sense of perspective to where we stand. And I hope that perspective will give rise to faith. And I hope your faith will give rise to peace. And I hope your peace will give rise to witness, even in a world that's marked by madness. So for today, and to that end, I've chosen that we would look through Psalm 146, which is great at providing a sense of perspective, especially to those who find themselves living in the midst of uncertainty. So if you have your Bible open, you can read along with me. Here's what's written beginning in Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord while I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Do not trust in princes, in mortal man in whom there is no salvation. His spirit departs, he returns to the earth. In that very day, his thoughts perish. How blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the seas and all that are in them, he who keeps faith forever, he who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord raises up those who were bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord protects the strangers. He supports the fatherless and the widow. And he thwarts the way of the wicked. The Lord will reign forever. The God, thy God, O Zion, to all generations. And he closes where he began. Praise the Lord. So the first portion of the psalm that's set before us this morning is really calling us to be people of confidence. This psalm begins, as do the four psalms that follow it, that finish out the book of the Psalms. It begins with the word hallelujah, or the expression, praise the Lord. That's what hallelujah means. praise the Lord. The end, Yah, that's the name of God, short for his covenant name, Yahweh. Halal, Hebrew word that means praise. So together, hallelujah means praise the Lord. Halal comes from a root word that means to shine. So praise carries with it the idea of reflecting. That is, something that shines gets reflected. And praise is, in effect, reflecting back to God our understanding and our admiration and our confidence in who He is in being and in character. Now, when he starts with this one word, hallelujah, it's written in the plural. So this is really a call to the community of the people of God to be those who keep the greater reality of who God is on the forefront of their hearts and their minds. It's a call that it be God and not our circumstance that would govern our disposition. God, not our circumstance. Now, broadly, the word hallelujah, or the expression praise the Lord, is oftentimes sort of misunderstood or misused or not used widely and broadly enough. We most often hear the word hallelujah, or a little expression praise the Lord, as a response to something that's turned out really well. I got an A on the test. I got a date for homecoming. The baby is healthy. I got the new job. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And in that instance, it becomes sort of a sanctified version of yippee. Right? Things went really, really well, and that's good. And it's better than good. It's right to respond with gratitude to God for the way that He provides in the midst of those things, because He's the giver of every good thing. That is right. But this psalm that sits before us this morning is a call to praise God even when things are difficult. It's written with the understanding that things don't always go well for the people of God. You may have seen as I read through it, but down into the psalm, beginning in verse 7, he mentions things like oppression and hunger and imprisonment and blindness, and being aliens, and widowhood, and orphans. But even in the face of those things, what he's doing is calling us to be people of confidence, even in those hard places. In fact, I would say it's part of what praise really is. It's confidence in hard places. It's kind of what Paul describes in Romans chapter 8. In Romans chapter 8, over in the New Testament now, Paul describes things like tribulation and distress and persecution and famine and nakedness and peril and sword. He lists those things as possible experiences for the follower of Christ, but he states that those things will not separate us from the love of God in Christ. And even in the midst of those, we are more than conquerors. That doesn't mean that we don't experience them, but it does mean that we're not defined by them. You can see, moving on in verse 2, that just like a chain is composed of individual links, this broad call to be people of praise and confidence comes down to individual resolve, person to person, to do just that. You can see what he says here. He says, I will praise the Lord while I live. I will sing praise to God while I have my being. There's again this sense that being a person who is a person of praise is really a sense of personal commitment. We don't know who wrote this psalm, but whoever it was has determined and is determined that his life will be marked by a disposition of praise, a disposition of confidence of God. And it's not just an ecstatic overflow. That's not the way it's described. He doesn't describe himself like a champagne bottle that's been shaken up and the cork is popped and stuff goes flying all over the place. It's not that at all. A disposition of praise is in many ways a spiritual discipline. Just the way that there are things that you and I can and must do in order to allow God to do what only He can do, like time in the Word of God, like prayer, like silence, like fasting, where we position ourselves for God to work through us the way that He desires, so too is the discipline of praise. In fact, here's one of the ways that I've been thinking about it. I, like many of you, I'm a person who can be dragged down by my circumstance. I can get mired in the mud of what I am walking through in my life. So this last week, going through this psalm, working my way through it, it was a great reminder to me. And somewhere along the line, I noticed something that became a way that I started thinking about this idea of being a person who praises God in the midst of it all. See, I started looking at the word praise, and this is not like official, this is not like etymology of the word or anything, but I started looking at the word praise, and I looked, contained inside the word praise is the word raise. So I started thinking about this. This is a little dorky, I'll admit, but I started looking at this word praise, and I think contained in it is the word raise. And I started thinking that praise is when I'm going to raise the sight line of my outlook. I'm going to raise it off of the immediate reality of my circumstance. I'm going to raise the sight line of my outlook, the eyes of my heart, off of the immediate reality of my circumstance, and I'm going to place the eyes of my heart on the always greater reality of the character of God. And I did that, and I start going through this very psalm. I started praying my way through it, taking the things that are said about God in this psalm and turning them back into praise to Him. For instance, it says that He is the God who's made the heaven and the earth. And I begin to reflect on that back to God, that He's the one who made that He is the one who made the heaven and the earth. Think about that for just a second. I begin to say, Lord, I praise You that You're the one who made heaven and earth, that You are infinitely creative and more resourceful than anyone could ever imagine. Lord, I praise You that You spoke into nothing and You brought forth something. God, You are so incredibly wise and powerful that You have put everything in its place and You maintain the universe with this precise sense of balance and this incredible sense of fine-tuning. Lord, I praise You that You say in the book of Colossians that it's in You that all things hold together. God, You're the one who keeps everything from flying apart. God, I praise You that You said in the book of Genesis that You spoke into the primordial chaos when things were formless and void and You brought forth order and beauty. Lord, I praise You that You are not daunted by a mess, but that You can look at things that are swirling all around and bring forth order and beauty. Well, I took that next line where He says, He made the seas and all that are in them. And throughout the Bible, the sea represents that which is mysterious and vast and dark and threatening. In fact, there's an old saying that said, if you want to teach a man to trust God, send him to sea. Because the sea is powerful and uncontrollable, and it doesn't take long at sea for a person to realize I'm not nearly as powerful and in control as I thought I was. But we're told here, God is the maker and the ruler, even of the sea. You know what? That's why so many of the God moments throughout Scripture take place out on the water. So that this God of the universe can demonstrate His mastery of the mysterious. So begin to praise God that He's greater than the oceans of threatening circumstance that might sit out before us. that he's the one who can part the sea or calm the storm or appoint a great fish as a way of deliverance. I'm thinking through this and I'm remembering contained in the word praise is the word raise. And I was deciding to raise my sight line off of the immediate reality of my circumstance and put them on the always greater reality of who God is in character and being. And as I did, you know what I began to discover is my disposition began to rise as well. See, it's the hope. It's the hope that perspective will give rise to faith. And that faith will give rise to peace. And that the peace then might give rise to witness, even in the midst of a world of madness. Now, not all my mornings were like that. And I didn't get up that day when the alarm went off at 6 a.m. and whatever time it was, I didn't bound out of bed like a fountain of joy. I wasn't like a soda can that had been shaken and spraying praise all over the place. It was a discipline. It was a decision in the midst of this. I've got to set the eyes of my heart on the one who is greater than all of this. I think that's what Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 is getting at. When it calls us to be those who run the race before us with endurance, not tangled in the sin that besets us, but fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for joy set before him endured the cross. You know what that means? Jesus himself chose to lift the sight of his eyes off of the immediate reality of his circumstance, which was the cross before him. And he raised the sight line of his outlook to the always greater reality of what God was up to, so that through the joy set before him, he endured the cross. It seems to me that in this season, this is an important thing for us, isn't it, church? To not let our circumstance govern our disposition, but to fix our eyes on the ever greater reality of what God is up to. That's what he does in the remainder of this psalm. You know, he gives us a call to be people of confidence, but then he gives a caution against trusting man and not God. You can see it in verses 3 and 4. He says it forthright. Do not trust in princes, in mortal man in whom there is no salvation. His spirit departs. He returns to the earth. In that very day, his thoughts perish. And he's telling us, don't trust in man. We understand this. He's saying, don't trust in man because man is both limited and temporary. He can't provide salvation. And before you know it, he's going to return to the earth. The way that C.H. Spurgeon put it, a preacher from many, many years ago, he said, hopes will surely fall to the ground which are built upon men who so soon lie under the ground. A little note that I wrote down as I was working through this is eventually every single one of us will be a lame duck. He said, don't trust in man or in princes, is the way he put it. Now, I mentioned earlier that we don't know who wrote this psalm, actually, but there is some opinion and there is some evidence that this particular prayer was written in what's called the post-exilic portion of the Old Testament. That means this. There's the nation of Israel in the Old Testament. God raised them up to be his chosen people. Over time, things went badly for the nation of Israel. They compromised, and as a result, that nation split into two nations, Israel and Judah. Well, they didn't do particularly well that way, and eventually Israel, because of their disobedience, was carried away in exile, and they ceased to be as a nation. Judah remained, and Judah didn't behave especially well either, and they too were carried off into exile into the land of Babylon, where according to the word of God, they would spend 70 years as prisoners. They were in exile, post-exilic has to do with the time when Judah came back to Jerusalem from their time in exile, according to the Word of God. Now, humanly speaking, instrumental in their return was a king of Persia by the name of Cyrus. Cyrus was the leader of the world almost at that point in time, and he gave permission to the people of Judah to return to Israel and to rebuild their lives there. Now, here's a little bit of context to this point. Cyrus had just recently become the king, the conqueror. Before that, it was the king of Babylon. In fact, the title king of Babylon was equivalent to the most powerful force in the world. So Cyrus, king of Persia, came along and conquered the most powerful conqueror in the world. Here, the world's greatest power was conquered by Cyrus. And Cyrus was very inclined toward the people of God. So much so that he said, you're free to go back to your land. And along with letting him go back, he loaded the people up with silver and gold to go back and rebuild their temple. On top of that, he went to the storage unit there in Persia and he gathered up all the vessels from the temple that had been stolen during the exile and gave them back and sent the people on their way. He was really making a way for them. He was making a way for them to return. He was making a way for them to rebuild. So it would have been very, very easy for the people at that time to put their trust in who? Cyrus. It would have been very easy for them to see Cyrus as the source of their success. It would have been very easy for them to worry that his reign was going to cease and that they would then suffer because Cyrus was gone. But what might not have been obvious to the people of that time living under that experience is that it was actually God at work in Cyrus's heart. The book of Ezra tells us all about this. In Ezra chapter 1 and verse 1 tells us this. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia. And he sent a proclamation throughout his kingdom that said, go home and take the gold and take all of these things. See, Cyrus thought he was playing to a political advantage. And what Cyrus was really doing was responding to the sovereign hand of God working behind the scene of human history. It's God and not Cyrus who is in charge. See, God is the conqueror of the greatest conqueror. God is more powerful than the one who overpowered the world's greatest power. And in the midst of this, we're told, don't trust in princes. Don't trust in man. But he's telling us to fix our eyes, remembering that God is both great in power and might, and good, as he's the one who feeds the hungry and raises up those who are bowed down. He calls on us to remember that God is the one who is our help and our hope, as he says in verse 5. How blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is the Lord his God. Help has to do with right now, very present strength available. Hope stretches into the future. When we get there, God is still going to be on his throne. Friends, this call to not trust in princes or in man, it's not a call for us to abandon society and to abandon government. It's not a time for us to say, like, I'm driving down the road and I'm going to trust God and let go of the steering wheel. Jesus, you take the wheel. That's not what he's calling us to do. We're called to be subject to the governing authorities, which in our republic is the law of the land. Folks, we're called, the law invests us with the right and responsibility of choosing those who will govern. As citizens, we can and we must stay engaged with what's going on. But as citizens of the heavenly kingdom, folks, we have got to watch our hearts. And we've got to watch our hope. That we should not be wringing our hands as those who have no hope. Not at all. Our God is on his throne. Now, I don't know what you think about the election that's at hand. I've talked to lots of people who are not real thrilled with any of the options. I think we ought to take to heart that God has done some pretty amazing things through some pretty unlikely people. And then in the midst of this, we should be people in the midst, along with exercising all the responsibilities and rights that we have, that we be people who raise the sight line of our outlook off of the immediate reality of our circumstance onto the always greater reality of God's character and being. Because, you know, he says in the end, he is the one who will reign forever, the God of Zion to all generations. And he ends us right where he started, with a call to the community of the people of God to be people of confidence, people of praise. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for who you are. Lord, would you stir our minds? Would you bring to mind reality of who you are always, that we would not be awash in our fears, that we would not be awash in our speculations, that we would be light, we would salt, we'd be engaged, we would be active, that we would not swim about as those who have no hope. Lord, we trust you. Because you're the one who will reign forever. Thank you, Lord, that you've made way where we can know and experience you through Jesus Christ, your very Son. That you tell us there's salvation in no one else. There's no other name by which we might be saved than that of Jesus himself. For that we praise you, and in him we trust you. Lord, help us to be those who follow close and finish strong. In Jesus' name, amen.
Friends, from the book of Isaiah, chapter 28. So this is what the sovereign Lord says. See, I lay a stone in Zion, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone for a sure foundation. The one who relies on it will never be stricken with panic. Friends, let's respond to what we just heard by praising our cornerstone, Christ Jesus. Let's stand. We're going to do it in the right key, too. I'm sorry, that was my fault. My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Sing that again. My hope is built. My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior. Storm. He is Lord,
darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Sing faultless. Faultless to stand before.
I love it. Even singing something like that, right? You take your sight line, you start raising it up, right? There's one who reigns above. There's a greater reality. We keep our eyes fixed and focused on that. Thanks again for being here this morning. Just a couple things as you make your way out. If you need someone to pray with this morning about anything, we always have some prayer shepherds that are up in the front, and they would love to stand with you and pray for you this morning. It'd be a real privilege to do that. Second, we have a new young adult gathering that's beginning this evening, 7 o'clock, and you'll see information on that in your bulletin. And we'd invite you, if you're somewhere between 18 and 35, to kind of connect and be a part of that group and chance to get to know others and grow together. Now, also, there's a blood drive going on. I'm sure they could fit you in if you wanted to give the gift of life this morning. And then also, tomorrow evening is our fall festival. We've been talking about praying about that for a good while now, as we want to throw our arms open to our neighborhood, to our community, to be a real benefit to them, to provide a cool and safe evening for kids and their families. So maybe you'll come out and be a part of that tomorrow night, and there may still be some opportunities to serve. If you'd like to be a part of that, you can stop by the table in the foyer this morning, and I want you to know about that. There are other things there. We'll let you pay attention to those as time allows. So let me close this, and we'll go about our way. Lord, I pray right now that you would that you'd be working all of us, Lord, in the ways that you know are needed, that you would raise a perspective that we need about you and your reality. And that perspective would keep giving way to faith. And faith would keep giving way to peace. And peace would give way to witness in the middle of a world that so much needs to know that there is a living hope that's in you through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So we look to you now as we go out, Father. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.